Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is to take a decision on whether we take items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed on that?
Agreed.
Yep. Thank you very much. So our agenda item number 2 is the DWP role in devolved social security. And this morning we're going to hear from Chloe Smith, MP, Minister for Disabled People, Health and Work, to discuss how the Department for Work and Pensions is supporting the Scottish Government in its implementation of social security provisions of the Scotland Act 2016. There is an interdependence between the hybrid Scottish and UK systems, both in terms of delivery infrastructure and decision making, and the committee is keen to develop its working relations across the nations, both at parliamentary and governmental level. So I welcome to the meeting Chloe Smith, Minister for Disabled People, Health and Work. And the Minister is accompanied by Andrew Latto, the Deputy Director of Pensioner Benefits and Carers Allowance Policy within the Devolution Team, and Margarita Morrison, the Area Director for Work and Pension Services Scotland at the Department for Work and Pensions. And I will start by inviting the Minister to make a short opening statement before moving to questions from committee members. Over to yourself, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Whittaman. Can I first of all double check that you can hear me and see me as you'd expect to?
Yes, we can. Technology. We can. Yeah, thank you.
Great. That's an excellent place to start. Well, thank you very much indeed, Ms. Whittaman, for inviting us today and for your predecessor having issued the invitation. We're very pleased to be here to talk about the issues at hand. And I wondered if it might just be helpful to make a few, as you invite me to, broader remarks before we start. And what I wanted to begin by saying was underlining our long-standing commitment to the UK, at the UK government, to devolution. Of course, the Scotland Act, as you know, devolves significant social security powers to the Scottish Parliament, full legislative responsibility transferred to Scottish ministers in 2016, with executive competence passing on in 2020 in April. So a range of benefits continue to be administered by DWP under agency agreements on behalf of Scottish ministers. And what that means in practice is that my department and I continue to work in close collaboration with the Scottish Government, including Social Security Scotland, at both ministerial and official level to support the implementation of the devolved powers. By way of example, this includes sharing information to support the administration of the new benefits, such as carers allowance supplement, providing access to our customer information systems to identify and verify information, as well as giving Social Security Scotland use of our payment and accounting services. As you'll know, we've already commenced the transfer of some existing clients with DLA children cases, and joint planning is underway in relation to the transfer of the other existing caseloads. And I think our core priority here, our core shared priority, is to do this safely and securely without disruption to claimants. Now, all of this is not without its challenges, which, of course, it will be good to discuss today. And I think we're all aware that there's a really ambitious to-do list ahead of us in 2022. The resource, of course, that this requires from both governments is considerable. And I think, as we saw during the pandemic, we are at our strongest when we are able to work together to achieve these common goals. So it's absolutely essential to maintain an open dialogue between the two governments to ensure that we understand the Scottish Government's policy and design at the earliest opportunity, and especially in cases where the Scottish Government is relying on DWP to support its delivery, that allows us to do the necessary planning and to avoid having unnecessary interdependencies at a policy, data or operational level. As we move forward, of course, many people in Scotland will receive support from both governments, many recipients of Scottish Social Security benefits also having reserved DWP benefits and employment support. So again, we need to have very clear, close working together, which we intend to do, to help claimants to be clear about how to get the support they need from both organisations. And as and when systems diverge in the future, then we intend to continue to work very closely with the Scottish Government to understand the relationship between the devolved and reserved elements to make sure that we take into account people's experiences. So for me, I really want to work together to deliver all this because I want Scottish people to get the support and the opportunities that they need. And I think when we do work together successfully, we're helping people to be safer and stronger and more prosperous. for me, I see it as an absolute privilege to be in this role and therefore to be with you today answering questions in the committee, because it's so important to provide that foundation at scale for so many citizens. As you mentioned, Ms. Whittam, I'm accompanied today by Andrew Latto, who's my Deputy Director for Devolution, and Margarita Morrison, who will be able in particular, I think, to illustrate how we serve Scottish people on the ground through the job centres and so much more.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your opening statement. I'm now going to move straight into questions from members. There is a lot of interest, as you can imagine, this morning to put questions to you, Minister. And I would urge my colleagues that if a question has been answered, if we can make sure to allow enough time for discussion to reframe your question a little bit. We do have five broad themes that we're going to be looking at. So the first is going to be UK disability benefit reform. We're then going to move on to questions around about passported benefits, then on to case transfer, then on to Scottish child payment data sharing, and finally ending with some questions around about the fiscal framework review. So I'm going to start off with my colleague Miles Briggs, who's in the room, and then we'll move to Pam Duncan-Glancy, who's also in the room. Over to yourself, Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to start with looking at how the systems worked during the pandemic, because I think we'd all accept that there's been really unprecedented pressures put on the social security system. So I wanted to ask specifically how the systems, both within DWP but also working with Social Security Scotland, have been able to actually respond to that.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Mr. Briggs. And this is, of course, critical, because I think actually one of our really core common goals here ought to be, of course, how we recover from the pandemic and support people in doing so right across the United Kingdom. And certainly that's forefront in my mind. I mean, I think the sort of scale of what we've been able to do speaks for itself, actually, because what you see, what you saw during the pandemic was the way in which we had to work together to be able to face up to, you know, one of the biggest challenges in recent memory. If you look at what we were able to do, for example, through the furlough scheme and more, you know, you can see to the tune of 900,000 jobs in Scotland haven't been supported or indeed protected by the UK government's scale. So that's just to begin to give an idea of the extent of what we have been through. Of course, at the same time, you had systems like universal credit hugely ramping up again to be able to support people in their hour of need. And I can pass to Margarita if she'd like to add some more practicality about what that looked like, you know, in the immediate circumstances as people walk through the door of job centres in need. What I would then just point to as well is, as I say, how much we have to do now together to recover. Much of that can be supported from DWP services and in the common work that we've got to do together that I've already been talking through. But of course, a lot of this is much wider as well into the broader needs of the economy. Would it be helpful, Mr. Briggs, if I do let Margarita say something just on the front line part?
Yeah, thank you, Minister. We practically doubled our caseload at the beginning of COVID, so it was very important that we brought on additional colleagues. We brought in about 1,200 additional work coaches in Scotland, and we did fast-track training to make sure they could do the immediate things, and that was about getting people paid. Our job centres remained open throughout, and even during the period where the whole country was closed down, we made sure that we were doing customer welfare calls, so that we could understand people at home and any help that we could provide with them. And if there was any issues of concern, we passed them over to our advanced customer service leads to make sure that they were in touch and they can talk through and help and support what the customer actually needed. We do work very closely with Scottish Government. We have a joint operational forum where issues are discussed. But the key thing for us was to make sure that people had the money in their pockets, and then we could then start to talk to them about their future at a later stage of the pandemic. And so it worked very well. I'll get the exact figure, but it was mid-90% that we got people paid on time at the beginning of the pandemic, so the system stood up extremely well.
Thank you for that. That's very good to hear. I wanted to ask further to that, now we're coming out of the pandemic, the future plans we have, before I come on to some of the disability benefit reform questions, how is the labour market in Scotland recovering, and some key programmes which we really need to see to help people into work, for example, the Kickstart programme, How is that being embedded in Scotland as well?
Would you like to take that?
Yes, certainly. And so on the Kickstart programme, we've had significant success with that, about 11,000 young people into work over the last period, which has been really exciting. Some fantastic stories, both on the disability and ill health front. Mental health has been a very big issue during the pandemic, and we've taken extra care, give support, either over telehealth. We tend to favour face-to-face and give that direct support to the customer, but we will do telephony if there is a mental health issue or anything else that the customer has explained. That taught us a lot in terms of pace and speed, just really important to get people into work very, very quickly, particularly those that have just come out of work and are very keen to get back into the labour market. A lot of great stories. We've used a lot of the learning of Kickstart, and in our Way to Work programme now, we're making sure that we're equally talking to our employers out there, bringing them on site, and trying to cut away some of the paperwork that we do, like CVs and supporting letters, to make sure that we can join up the employer and the young person, or the person looking for work, our plus 25 customers, etc., so that they can get a chance to have a great conversation. And we have seen customers leaving the job centre with a job because we've had the employer on site. The other thing that we're doing is the success of our jobs fairs and our youth hubs were very successful, because in the youth hubs, for example, we had young customers there who got peer support from other young customers, as well as the support, for example, our Ibrox youth hub was extremely successful in that people had a connection there and were able to talk through what they wanted to do with other people. So real success there. In addition to that, we want to take some of that forward now for our older customers to make sure that they get the opportunity of that. We're looking at that at the moment. But the other thing we're doing on a large scale is job fairs throughout Scotland. And as an example of that, towards the end of March, we're going into every local authority area that would like us to. And at the moment, we're speaking to them, and that, you know, appears to be a lot of them, where we can carry out care job fairs. And because we do feel that a lot of our customers have got those entry-level skills that will help the care sector during the time where they have unemployment. So we're hoping, vacancies. So we're hoping that we can really assist with that. So we have a number of initiatives on the go, and we are also talking to Scottish Government. One of the additional things we're doing with Scottish Government is we're doing a pilot in Dundee with Dundee City Council and Scottish Government on lone parents, really just trying to understand what are the current barriers to work and overcoming those together so that we can help them get work. Hopefully that's a flavour.
Yeah.
No,
may I add a... Sorry, Mr. I was just going to add a... Because part of your question also was the sort of the scale of the statistics, if it would be helpful, I just wanted to add to the extent that, you know, at the UK level, of course, as the economy continues to rebound and we come back after the pandemic, you know, you're seeing 1.2 million vacancies currently available, which are, you know, many of which are in sectors absolutely vital for our recovery. So the priority is to be able to go further and go faster and help people into the jobs that they can do right now, find a job, progress in work, thrive in the labour market, wherever that may be. And of course, at a Scotland level, if I look at the rates of those who are seeking work, the number of Scottish people seeking work actually has come down on the previous quarter, which I think is a positive thing. And indeed, it's lower than the rate of the same rate for the UK as a whole, 3.6% compared to 4.1%, which I think is a positive position to be looking from.
Yeah, thank you for that. I'm pleased to hear that about that work, and it would be useful if you could keep the committee informed on any of these programmes as they're developed as well. I think we'd all appreciate advanced knowledge around that. Moving on, I also wanted to ask, finally, before I hand back to yourself, Convener, with regards to how the DWP and Social Security Scotland have functioned and worked together during this period. We know that there's going to be significant work coming forward involving the Scottish Government, especially in developing proposals around changing PIP and DLA. So I just wondered how that relationship's been built. I know yourself and the Minister went to university together here, so I think it's hopefully there's positive relationships being built at a government level. But how are the two organisations working together to help make that as smooth a transition as possible?
Well, you're absolutely right on that. Mr McPherson and I have actually had a chance to know each other in a couple of different roles, and it's a pleasure to continue to work with him. So yes, exactly. At ministerial level, we have the right relationships to exchange the the ideas, the work, the detail that we need to do. We meet regularly. Of course, that's also supported by the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare, which is the sort of structure that, that goes around our work as individual ministers. In addition to that, my officials run at various levels of programme, you know, run all the work that is necessary to cooperate. And actually on that, I wonder if I might bring in Andrew to be able to mention a few more parts of that. I will say that this has, of course, been a lot of extensive work, considering that we're talking about what's been needed since the earlier legislation that brought about the devolution, and considering the length of time still to play in some of the agency agreements and the work that I referred to in my opening remarks, you know, these are relationships that we'll need to endure as well. But if I invite Andrew to describe a bit more.
Yes, I'll be very happy to. Thank you, Minister. I mean, there are a number of informal and formal government structures between the two governments. The most established ones are around Fair Start Scotland, with the Fair Work part of the Scottish Government and the contractors that deliver Fair Start Scotland. So we've got a model that works, and we're trying to transfer the bits of that that work across to cooperation on social security. If I might characterise it, I'd say there are three communities. There's the operational community, so there's Margarita and Margarita's counterpart in Social Security Scotland, Mr. Wallace. There are the two devolution programmes. There's one in DWP, which is turning things off, and one in Scottish Government, which is turning things on. And that has very formal structures, as it will have to, because of the nature of the work that's being undertaken. And then there's my community, which is the policy community, and I talk very frequently to my counterpart in the Scottish Government. The one you've asked about, though, I think is the developing relationship between Social Security Scotland and DWP operations. That's probably the one that's the most work in progress. We certainly cooperated a lot during the pandemic. So our excellent colleagues in Social Security Scotland were delivering carers land supplements, Scottish health payment, funeral expenses, all of those things. But inevitably, we had to carry on delivering DLA for children when we had intended to replace that with child disability payment. That's an effect of the pandemic. And we also had very practical discussions. You know, we have a lot of people who work in Dundee, you know, the job centres, pension centres, or whatever it is. Social Security Scotland's main centre is in Dundee. They can help us, we can help them when we've got peaks and troughs of work, because we've got people trained to do very similar work.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much for that. I'll now hand over to my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy, and after that will be Jeremy Balfour. Pam?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and your officials. It's good to meet you. I just want to start on the kind of disability benefit reform, but also with a word of caution about the workplace statistics that you shared. Some of those statistics may indeed hide some inequalities in the workforce and in the workplace, and they also may be people getting into work that isn't necessarily secure long term, or more hours than just a few, and in some cases 0 hours. So it's just to ask that perhaps some of that data is also considered, so that we make sure that the whole economy and everyone in it is doing better, and not just some of us. On the disability benefit reform, I'd be really keen to start by asking a question about access to work, actually, and where that sits with that, and whether or not the Minister believes that some of the changes put in place during the pandemic for access to work around electronic submission of claims, etc., which actually were quite useful for a number of disabled people, could be made permanent. And I have two further questions after that, but they're short.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Duncan-Glancy, and it's great to join you at the committee. I understand your point about the statistics, actually, first off, and if I may, I just want to underline how committed I also am to supporting, in particular, disabled people and those with health conditions in the right way into employment. And I think for me, actually, it's not just to start a job, it's to start and stay and succeed in a job, and I hope those would be values that we all share as we scrutinise data that really, of course, is about people's lives, not about numbers. Yep. So coming on to access to work, I'll just make a few brief points, and then I'll draw on Margarita for the practicality of how this has been run through her job centres. Indeed, there have been a few easements that we've made in access to work, as we had across a number of different DWP services through the pandemic. And I think the broad point for me is that I'm really open to reviewing those, learning from them, and taking forward the good afterwards, after the pandemic, in the recovery that we're now looking towards. I think for me, the key as well in access to work is that we want to be able to make sure people are getting the support quickly. And I'm conscious that over the last couple of years, there have been delays in people getting access to work. We've been open about that and open about how we are working to try to get those down. Bless you, Margarita. Get those down and, as I say, get the support where it's needed as quickly as possible. For example, right now we are ensuring that those who have a job offer, or indeed a self-employed person who needs to start something, that we are processing those applications inside 4 weeks, because we think that's the right thing to do to support a person, you know, as they need it at the sharp end. If I just turn to Margarita, you might be able to add a bit more about what that's been like through the pandemic and what it looks like now.
Some of the just to sort of give you some top headlines, then I'll give you some information on what's actually happening in job centres. So over the past 18 months, the Access to Work has delivered in-depth upskilling sessions to a wide variety of internal colleagues, including our work coaches, our disability employment advisors, and our employer advisors. Externally, we've provided awareness of Access to Work to a range of organisations, employers, customer representative groups, and this will continue throughout 2022. Focusing activities in areas with the largest disability employment gap in Scotland. We frequently promote Access to Work through the department's social media channels and have introduced specific Access to Work pages on the Job Help website. We're taking a range of steps to continue to raise awareness of Access to Work among people with a disability or health condition in all parts of the country. We regularly promote the scheme through department's channels and Access to Work pages. We're also ensuring our advisers who work with potential claimants, including Job Centre Plus health professionals and advisory groups, have the information. We're talking regularly to disability confident employers, of which there are 1,400 in Scotland, to make sure that we can work in collaboration to get the best outcome for our customers. In terms of some practical things that we're doing, we're working very closely at the moment in some of our offices with GP surgeries, just to understand better. We've got work coaches in there at the moment so that we can understand what the barriers are. We work with Autism Scotland around autism accreditation and making our job centres better places to be, so that people have a calm atmosphere in which to talk to us about their aspirations. We have pilot health model offices in Scotland at the moment, and that's really just working along with our NHS colleagues and others, really just to try and understand what barriers are there and how we can jointly overcome them. We have advanced customer support. So I mentioned it earlier, that where we think someone needs more time on their application or in the discussion we're having with them, we will make referrals to advanced customer support, or particularly our disability employer advisors. They carry out a dual role. They can talk to customers about their needs and overcome the barriers with them, but they can also, and they are, training our work coach colleagues so that everybody has got awareness and knows where to go on matters such as that. We also have youth employee work coaches, and they work with claimants with multiple barriers. And again, our youth hubs has helped provide another environment that we can take them to and spend the necessary time with them to make sure we get the right outcomes for them. So just a flavour there.
Thank you both for that. That's really helpful. My other question is, how does the Minister and also the DWP plan to include the Scottish Government in the development of the reforms to personal independence payment, and how much consideration is being given to the effect on potential case law divergence?
Thank you for that question, and I suppose in many ways that brings us onto the areas where we have or we have such close work to do together. Of course, what's happening is that the Scottish Government is introducing its ADP, adult disability payment, replace PIP from and that's from March this year in three local authority areas, two further early implementation areas, and then full national rollout at the end of August. So what we're, of course, doing is to make sure at a legislative level that that is, orderly. For example, I was taking through some Scotland Act orders just recently to support the introduction of ADP. In much greater detail, though, there is then the full devolution programme that is working together to make sure that this is a safe and secure transfer. I'll start with the kind of general points. Obviously, the design and any questions to do with ADP would be for the Scottish Government to answer for you, and anything in terms of PIP. Are questions that I and the team here today would be able to try to tackle for you. But I think the key point for me is that we do want to be able to jointly have a stable system that is getting people the support that they need on time. And in as far as the PIP side of things goes, I do acknowledge that there can be in some cases an amount of time that people are waiting for a PIP decision to come through. That's been in large part due to the pandemic, with various problems to do with assessments that have related to how people can be seen. But there's a number of ways that we can work together, we at DWP and with Social Security Scotland, to make sure that we, between us, have the right assessors in place and the right processes in place, of course, to support that, so that people are getting the support that they need.
Could I just ask for some clarification? Sorry, Minister, I probably wasn't as clear in my original question as I should have been. It was more in relation to the Green Paper that proposes changes to disability benefits at the UK level, which might indeed have an impact on people in Scotland. And it was just to ask what sort of engagement you have with the Scottish Government on that particular process.
Oh, I'm sorry, I did misunderstand your question. Thank you for clarifying that. So what we have here then is a broad piece of work actually on the part of the UK government, which is, as you say, a green paper to do with the health and disability benefits. It's called Shaping Future Support, and that was brought out last year. And in that, as you know, we are committed to bringing forward a white paper this year. So work has gone on to get actually a great range of responses in on the consultation, 4,500, in fact, which I really value. And then from there to shaping what we think may be the way forward to fulfil the objectives that we set out there in that green paper, which are, you know, rooted in supporting people to live independently and to have the right kind of experience of the benefits system, and also indeed to support people into work where that's appropriate. In terms of how we need to dovetail that with the Scottish Government, I think it's fair to say, actually, that, if you like, while that review is our piece of work, the Scottish Government also, I understand, has an independent review on its side. And I think it's actually quite right and fair that, you know, those two pieces of work are within each of our responsibilities. Where we will need to work together is to ensure that we are doing a safe and secure transfer of people from those who've been claiming the reserve benefits to the ADP in Scotland. So in as much as it's in a shared space, I'm always very happy to have conversations with my Scottish Government colleagues about our green paper. But actually, I think it may be the case that we've got two quite understandable different lines of work going here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I'll hand over now to Jeremy Balfour for his questions. I know my colleague Marie McNair has had her question on this theme answered, so then we'll go back to Pam Duncan-Glasey for theme two after that. Jeremy?
Yeah, good morning, Minister, and to your officials, and again, thank you for coming. I wonder if I can just follow up very briefly on a question for my colleague Pam in regard to access to work. It seems to me it's one of these hidden secrets that a lot of people don't know about, and I was interested your official saying what they're trying to do to promote it more. I'm just wondering, is this a joint piece of work that you've ever discussed? I know it's a DWP benefit and money comes from DWP, but it seems to me still that many companies, particularly smaller companies, medium-sized companies, don't know about access to work. I'm just wondering if you could maybe give us some idea about how we can even promote it better, both governments together on that.
Well, thank you very much indeed for that, Mr. Balfour, because I think there's a huge amount to do, actually, because access to work is so valuable and so needed to all our interests to be able to raise awareness, as you say. Access to work will, I mean, it is and will remain a scheme provided by the Department for Work and Pensions. So you know, we will retain responsibility for that. But nonetheless, I would hope that actually the message could go out from this committee and in other opportunities to as you say, raise awareness and information of it. What we've been doing recently on that is in various ways across the United Kingdom is working with stakeholder organisations to raise awareness and ensure that their members know about the scheme. We want to work with employer associations as well. We are working with disability charities and disabled people's organisations. I think that is absolutely critical. And may I say, by the way, that I want the voice of disabled people to be central in everything I do. So for me, it's very important to work with DPOs and others, and access to work is one good example of that. At an employer level, we find it's very positive to be able to promote access to work to employers as part of the Disability Confidence Scheme. And by way of example, there's 1,400 members of that in Scotland. So those are some of the ways in which recently we've been continuing to raise awareness. Margarita, would you like to add anything to that as to, again, the very front end?
Thank you, Minister. I think the other important thing, Minister, is that in the early 2020, the Access to Work Stakeholder Forum was established in Scotland, and this is led and chaired by disabled people's organisations, with DWP and Scottish Government officials working collaboratively to understand existing experience and explore opportunities for improvement and collaborate on policy developments. The group meets frequently and continues to contribute and provide insight in relation to the Access to Work scheme. It's consistent with our wider approach to stakeholder engagement, where similar forums in England and Wales operate, and all three chairs work together to ensure experiences and improvements, including views, are shared, and we have a collective approach to access to work administration and policy development. And therefore, any devolution of the Access to Work scheme could create an inconsistency there, so we're really keen to keep the collaboration with job centres and to make sure that we get that collaboration and understanding of ideas that work. And I've seen firsthand myself, in terms of employees in our own business in DWP, where we've used Access to Work grants to make sure they have the ability to get to work, stay at work, and have the right adjustments around about them to make sure that they have a pleasurable experience in our employment. So hopefully that helps.
Yeah, thank you for that. It's really helpful. I suppose my final question just on this area is in regard to the differential in regard to number of disabled people in employment in Scotland compared to England. So there's a higher number of people unemployed who are disabled in Scotland than there are in England, and the number is growing larger. I just wonder, on reflection, why you think that might be the case, and what do you think we can do, particularly here in Scotland, as we come out of this two-year pandemic, where disabled people might be left behind? How can we get more disabled people into safe employment, and also employment that gives them an opportunity to be promoted and to be fulfilled in their work?
Well, I think there's a huge amount to do under this heading, Mr. Balfour. It's a really important question, and you are correct, of course, on the figures. Across the UK, the disabled employment rate is 53%. Regrettably, in Scotland at 49%. We are very interested in actually two measures here, and in fact, these are both manifesto commitments for us. We're interested in helping greater numbers of disabled people into employment, and we set a goal in 2017 that actually over 10 years we wanted to help a million people more into employment. And we're seeing that happening. I think that goal will be met, and I'm pleased to see it. There'll be plenty more to do, of course, beyond that. But also the other type of measure that we're really interested in is the disability employment gap. And again, just to cite the figures, at the UK level, that gap, in other words, the gap in employment rates between disabled and non-disabled people, is 28%. And unfortunately, it's the case that in Scotland, it's 33%. So I'm looking at ways that we can bring all of our efforts to bear on helping disabled people into work. And as I said earlier, to not just be in work, but to start and stay and succeed in work. Actually, retention is critical. If you think about what would need to be the case for that gap to close, retention, of course, is absolutely critical. So helping people stay in the workplace if they should, for example, become in worse health, you know, while they're in work, we want to support that and help them stay. There's a number of tools that we're using to try to go about this. We've already mentioned Access to Work, and I've, in the course of that, I've mentioned the Disability Confidence Scheme, which are ways of engaging with employers to encourage them to do their part. bless you, Margarita. As Margarita's already mentioned herself, in job centres, we have disability employment advisors who are there to really support this effort, support claimants directly, but of course, critically support the colleagues, the officials in job centres, to be able to put the right expertise towards supporting disabled people. And we also have a large range of programmes of particular provision, which is there to support people with disability or ill health. I'm very excited actually about the way that some of those are going to move forward in the years to come. For example, we want to make sure that there will be increased time with the work coaches in the job centres and the right support through those programmes, so that we can continue to encourage disabled people to, as I say, start and stay and succeed in work.
Thank you. Thank you, Gwyn.
Thank you, Jeremy. I'm actually going to pass over to my colleague Marie McNair, who is joining us remotely, who does have a question now on this theme. Over to you, Marie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and thank you for coming along this morning to the committee. A lot of the points that I wanted to make have been covered, but just I've got one on PIP. Just really, will there be any changes from your proposals? We'll see changes to the PIP criteria prior to 2025. You will be aware that this is the target date for the completion of transfer from PIP to adult disability payment. You're looking really for assurances that there will be nothing that will put at risk the safe and secure transfer.
Over to yourself, Minister.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that question. Oh, sorry, can you hear me? Is there an issue on the line?
No, I can hear
okay,
you.
That's
we can
good.
Hear you. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for that question. As you say, and as I've already mentioned this morning, you know, the aim here absolutely is to ensure the safe and secure transfer of benefits, because of course behind that is people's lives. You know, we are talking about real people who need real support. So, as I've already covered, we intend to bring forward proposals in a white paper later this year, mid 2022, as I noted in my letter to the committee, to Ms. Whittam in February. And I appreciate that at the same time, as I've already said, there is an independent review that the Scottish Government is looking to take forward. So these two are perhaps in their way parallel strands. The key for me then will be to make sure that we are able to keep both of our schemes under review as the landscape evolves, and to do that in a way that has claimants firmly in mind.
Thank you.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you very much, Marie. I'll now move on to a question from Pam Duncan-Glancy on theme two. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you, Convener. Does the Minister believe that changing the eligibility criteria for the enhanced rate of mobility would impact on passported benefits?
Thank you very much for that question. May I... I'm sorry, we just had a little scuffle in the room. My colleague Andrew wanted to say something to the previous question. May I let him do that and then come to your question, if that would be OK?
Absolutely.
It is also relevant. So I wanted to say about the 2025 day, the key day really is August of this year, because that's the date on which ADP is available throughout Scotland. Anyone who has a new claim or who comes up for a reassessment for PIP won't be doing it in PIP, they'll be doing it in ADP. So changes we might make in England and Wales to PIP, or whatever they may or may not be, Would kind of be relevant, directly relevant to Scotland, because ADP will be the benefit that operates there.
Thank you very much for adding that, and Andrew. And I guess that follows on to the question that Pam actually just asked in terms of passporting benefits. Pam?
I could start, and then the Minister can follow. So on a kind of technical level, just to explain passporting, which is a phrase I dislike intensely. I prefer to say access to premiums, because actually what we need to do as DWP is find the right people who need the additional amount, whether they're disabled people or carers. We do it in different ways, in different benefits. So universal credit, for example, the assessment of care, whether somebody is a carer, is done within universal credit. It's not done by passporting from carer's allowance. So isn't using another benefit as a passport isn't the only way to find the people who need extra money in the reserve benefits. There are potentially other ways of doing it, but clearly, for as long as somebody has done an assessment, which is the assessment that we need, whether that's in DWP or the Scottish Government, there would not be a very good customer experience for us to ask somebody to go through a second assessment just to find out whether they can get an additional amount in universal credit alongside what they were getting from the Scottish Government. However, the whole point of devolving the disability benefits is precisely that the Scottish Government can take a different path from the UK Government. From a DWP point of view, we provide reserved benefits to everybody in Great Britain, and we will need to find the people who get the premiums. And if we can't use a Scottish Government benefit to do it because it's veered away from where the English and Welsh benefit is, then we will need to find another way of doing it. But we have to provide, whatever we provide to people in England and Wales, we have to provide it to people in Scotland as well. We have to find a way of achieving that.
Did that answer your question, or do you have a...
Thank you, that was really helpful. I'd be keen very helpful actually, and I'd be keen to just hear if the Minister has a view, and also whether that is the case. If the answer that's just been given, which is helpful, is true for carers' allowance as well. And also, at any point, have you threatened to label adult disability payment not comparable to PIP based on proposed changes to eligibility criteria that the Scottish Government may wish to take?
On carers' allowance, perhaps we might be able to come to that in a separate thread, if you like, because there's probably quite a lot to say around that and to bring together there. But sticking with the point on PIP and ADP, I mean, as Andrew has set out, clearly the construction of ADP and thresholds or qualification within that is absolutely a matter for the Scottish Government. I entirely agree, of course, with how he's set out the position in terms of any changes that may be the responsibility of the UK government in terms of PIP, and how these two things relate. You know, at a practical point, we of course continue to work very closely to understand each other's changes. But I do want to echo and be very clear about the distinction here, which is that decisions to do with the design of ADP are for the Scottish Government. And as Andrew has explained, access to premier through that is something that we have been able to take decisions on for the immediate.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. I'll now hand over to my colleague Marie McNair again, who is on Blue Jeans remote.
Thank you, Convener. And again, a number of the points is going to be covered. Ms. Duncan Glancy has asked about the 20-metre rule. Can you comment on the rationale for introducing it in the first place?
I'd be happy to. Although I would note that is of course, if you like, a sort of a historical point, and not one that is to do with the conjunction between reserved and devolved benefits, which I think is the point of this session. But the need, I think, in a benefit to support people with disability is to be able to understand in a sensitive way how their needs may be impacted by by their condition. Of course, in the case of PIP, we are primarily trying to understand what functional effect there is on a person's life, rather than provide support, by the label of condition. But that's the reason why there is a mobility rule at all. And we have sought to be able to set it at what we think is an appropriate level, so that we're getting the support to the people who need it the most.
Thank you.
Witnesses to our committee have been on record saying that the Westminster government introduced the rule to cut money from disability benefits. Do you dispute that?
Yes, I do. What we're trying to do in PIP, of course, and have always done, is to be able to get support where it's.
No further questions, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll now move on to Jeremy Balfour, who's in the room, and after that, Emma Roddick, who's remote.
Thank you, convener. I wonder if I can go back to the questions again, and the very helpful answer we got from the officials in regard to how we could assess, if we can just keep calling it passport benefits at the moment, just to, I think we all understand what we mean by that. Firstly, have there been discussions between the UK government and Scottish government about how we could access these passport benefits in another way if we weren't using PIP as the criteria? Have those discussions started at a ministerial or official level? And I just wonder if you could maybe explain a wee bit more about how that could happen. So if we had a divergence in regard to benefits here in Scotland compared to those in England and Wales, are there mechanisms that we could use to still allow people to get, for example, the Christmas £10 bonus you get if you get PIP at the moment, which is obviously linked to a particular. Is it possible to work on that, or is that going to be almost too complicated to do?
I think the broad answer really here, Mr. Balfour, is as I set out in my letter to the committee, which is, which is really the way that we've answered already to the questions this morning. So, in the immediate term, we have decided that the receipt of the equivalent elements of ADP and CDP will be the means of identifying these additional needs, and we think that is, we think that is a reasonable thing to do, and therefore have decided that is our best option. But as I said in the letter, the way of identifying those needs certainly can and will be kept under review as the benefit landscapes continue to evolve. And we've already pointed, of course, to our green paper and to the independent review, which are perhaps vehicles for how each government is able to look at these things ahead. I'm very happy perhaps to bring in Andrew if he wants to add about any further aspects of these discussions at official.
I don't have any friend of freedom.
Sorry, I'd like to make two comments. When is the Christmas bonus? So, Mr. Balfour, you're quite right to identify the Christmas bonus. That is a unique situation where we, as the Reserve, as the UK government, are giving some money to somebody who's been assessed as if they're getting a benefit by the Scottish government. And it is a direct link, and there is no other way of doing it, because the entitlement to the Christmas bonus derives from the entitlement to the other benefits. So, and the way we will deal with that, if we need to, is through the spillover effect, where if there's a cost to the UK taxpayer due to decisions made by Scottish ministers, then we will recruit that cost from the Scottish government. And we're in the process of working out how that works now. So that one is a very specific issue. On your other point about discussions with officials, at the moment, we think it's premature. There's a lot of work to be done simply to replace PIP with ADP, winter payments, cold weather payments, and so on. Our ministers are content for the time being that CDP and ADP are sufficiently, they meet the terms under which we would give people an increase in pension credit, for example. There is no need at the moment to think through how we would do that if those benefits veered significantly away, because they haven't yet. In due course, we would need to do that. I'm responsible for pension credit, for example. I am looking very carefully at how my universal credit colleagues deal with carers in the context of universal credit by not using carers' allowance, and getting the work coach to have a discussion with the carer to see what their caring responsibilities are. how could we do that on the pension credit side of things? But if I might say, without wishing to be rude, that is a matter for the UK government. I mean, we would keep our Scottish government colleagues informed. But yeah, the operation of the and the policy on the reserve benefit system is for UK government ministers.
Thank you, Gwynne.
Thank you, Jeremy. I'll now pass over to my colleague Emma Roddick, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener and Toll Minister. It's good to meet you, if virtually, and thank you for your time this morning. My question is very much along the same lines as my colleague Pam Duncan. I'd just like a little bit more clarity on policy change. You've said that you agree with the Minister that no further changes are possible to ADP at this time, but that it's for the Scottish criteria in future. Do you appreciate there has been devolution of some social security powers? There are limits to those powers, and we're not entirely clear yet on where those limits are in terms of what can be done without risking the eligibility of claimants of devolved benefits to continue to receive their reserve benefits. And is it your intention to reconcile that and facilitate the Scottish Government's policy wishes on devolved benefit?
Over to yourself, Minister. Hopefully you managed to get that.
Yes, thank you, I did, although unfortunately Emma's quality wasn't ideal. But thank you very much indeed, Ms Roddick, for your question. I mean, I hope we are being very clear this morning. We do not believe that there is such a risk. We think this is perhaps a misunderstanding, or dare I say, a red herring. We are really clear that the construction of the Scottish Government's benefit is a matter for them. And I hope I've also been able to be clear about the ways in which we understand that both our landscape and the Scottish Government's landscape may well evolve through our Green Paper and review, but B, that nonetheless we want to continue to work together to ensure that we have the safe and secure transfer of benefits in order to get support to the people who need it the most. I think Andrew wanted to add a point, which I'll let him do, and then I hope that really will answer your question.
Yeah, so if I could, I just wanted to get a hypothetical example. This is not real, not what the Scottish Government proposes, but in theory, the Scottish Government could replace PIP with something completely different, which isn't a benefit. It could use the money to do something else, to make infrastructure improvements. It's not going to, it's going to use it to pay a benefit. But if the Scottish Government decided to do that, we would still be left in DWP needing to find people in Scotland who could get a premium in the reserve benefits because of their disability. Even if there were no benefit in Scotland, we would still have to find a way of doing that.
Thank you, Emma. I know that I think you have a supplementary question to come back with.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I've certainly seen some difficulties around the hybrid nature of social security at this point in a Scottish context. Is the DWP also struggling with the hybrid nature, including, and do you see a need to increase devolved powers in future to remedy some of the issues that we've already covered this morning?
Thank you for that question. I don't see a need for there to be difficulties because, as we've been saying this morning, I think we do have really comprehensive ways of working together, actually. And I do think that working together is how we are going to be able to get the best result for people. I think we will be able to help people to be, as I've said before, safer and stronger and more prosperous if we work together sensibly. But on the subject of devolving further powers, I mean, I think there is a legitimate question to ask here, which is about, first of all, being able to really grip the powers that have been devolved. And considering, regrettably, that we're in a position where, for example, you know, we're looking at the end of the agency agreements, and yet still there are, you know, such large amounts of things to do, and for the Scottish Government to be ready to do so, I would certainly hope that actually there'd be a focus on making most use of the powers that have already been devolved and being ready to really deliver for citizens rather than necessarily looking for more powers.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. We'll now move on to questions in the next theme, which is round about case transfer. I know that Jeremy Balfour's had his question answered, so we'll move on to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy in the room and then Miles Briggs. Pam?
Thank you, Convener. Have the Scottish Government raised with the Department of Work and Pensions changing the 20-metre rule and the eligibility criteria of the mobility component as a priority?
I'm terribly sorry. Could I ask you to repeat the question? I didn't quite hear you.
Of course, apologies. Have the Scottish Government raised with you changing the 20-metre rule and the eligibility criteria of ADP of the mobility component as a priority?
Well, if they'd like to change it in the ADP, that's entirely for them. As to whether that's come up in conversation in terms of it being their responsibility to take such a decision, I don't believe that's been made with me, but I'll ask Andrew whether that's been made at an official level.
No. No, and frankly, I wouldn't expect them to, because it's a decision for the Scottish.
Thank you both. I have one follow-up question, Convener, thank you. Have you at any point insisted on adult disability payment eligibility criteria and descriptors remaining unchanged from the ones used in PIP?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. And I think, theme two, we've ventured into a lot of theme three as well. But I wanted to ask a question with regards to scale of resource, which DWP have had to commit to the transfer process as well, and whether or not you could outline what that's looked like. We know the additional and higher costs of delivering the social security system through Social Security Scotland. We hope that will come in line with the same projections DWP currently have, but I just wondered what that resource looked like currently.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Briggs. I mean, I think these are really essential questions, actually, and ones that we all want to see well delivered, again, for the reasons that I've been saying through the morning, because we want to see a safe and secure transfer of benefits and delivery for people who need it the most. I think, just to illustrate the point as I understand it, Social Security Scotland's staff requirements have, for example, doubled from the original estimated requirement, 1,900 up to 3,500. So it is really important to have accurate estimates of the resource that will be required. And certainly that will be true both in terms of staffing and, of course, the cost required. Again, the cost estimates could be argued to be considerably larger than what the Scottish Government might have first made. For our part, I mean, what we want to do here is to ensure that we have a sensible supporting dialogue and all structures necessary to make a success of this. Let me turn to Andrew, who might be able to explain what the resource commitment is in a programme level in terms of us working together with the Scottish Government to execute this devolution.
So, yes, if I might, I'd like to make two points, really. One is about the long-term, the steady state. There will be no PIP in Scotland, there will be no DMHR, the number of DWP benefits that won't exist, therefore there will be a saving to DWP because we won't be having to administer those benefits, but a cost to Social Security Scotland, that's in steady state. But there are, of course, start-up costs, and there are devolution programmes to our change professionals in both DWP and the Scottish Government who will not be there forever. They will be there for as long as it's necessary to move to the two parallel systems. It will be difficult to put an exact figure on it because a lot of people in DWP are working on Scottish devolution as part of another job. There are obviously some people who are dedicated to Scottish devolution, but I can't really put a figure on it for that reason. For example, everybody in DWP who is responsible for administering DLA for children at some point has been involved in the devolution of Social Security to Scotland, and that's quite a lot of people. The other point I was going to make is a sort of constitutional point, but the decision was made in the wake of the independence referendum that there would be the establishment of an autonomous social security system in Scotland. That comes with a cost. It is clearly not as efficient to have two social security systems as to have one. But there are reasons why that offer was made to the people of Scotland that this would be set up. So it is less efficient to have two systems.
Thank you for that. And I think none of us either you know, yourselves in the UK government or here in the Scottish Parliament want to see, you know, administration costs being the focus. It's getting money to the front line and to people who really need it. So I just wanted to finally ask, is the exercise which we're seeing presenting unprecedented complexity for the DWP, or is it similar in scale to previous benefit changes? And, you know, where is this potential, you know, increase in costs which we've seen coming from, and the additional staff the Scottish Government are now saying will be needed to administer the system? You know, what's within the system which is making this so complicated compared to, you know, other benefit changes which we've seen under DWP?
I'm going to let Andrew answer that question in the first instance, because actually he has a fantastic organisational history and memory here. So he'll
answer. I would say the nearest analogy would be tax credits. So the transfer, in the early 2000s of things like child premiums and income support to HMRC, we'd had a different ministerial team, different data structures, a different way of looking at the world, even, because HMRC is an organisation that generally takes money from people rather than giving money to people. So we did a lot of work around tax credits, and the reverse is true in bringing tax credits into universal credit. I think it's the fact that there are two different systems, which is the complexity and different procurement cycles. We're in different cycles of technology. DWP's IT is extremely advanced in the case of universal credit, but rather creaking, frankly, in the case of some other benefits, whereas Social Security Scotland has the opportunity to start from most modern technology. So I think that's what adds the complexity. I think there is a question that has been asked previously, which is part of the problem to do with kind of ideological differences between the two governments. Frankly, at an official level, no. The problem is we have different IT systems, different procurement cycles and those sorts of things.
If I may just add one point to that, or really just to emphasise a point from that. I mean, I think the point is fair that Andrew makes, that, you know, two systems is inevitably less efficient than one, in the sense that we both want to be able to support the same people with, you know, with in many cases the same needs and the same shared concerns. You know, in my view, when we do work collaboratively to tackle big problems, whether they be administrative or whether they be, you know, the kind of shocks we've seen in recent years, we are better able to draw on skills if we do that together and if we do that at scale.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much for that, Miles. I'm actually going to go back to my colleague, Emma Roddick, who unfortunately I cut off. I didn't realise she had another question because she froze on the screen. So, Emma, back to yourself, and hopefully your connection's OK. Yep, on you go. No. I think she's frozen again. Oh, no.
Thank you, convener. Thank you for your patience with my IT. Just wanted to come back in on two points in yours. First, on the issue of that we have, while I appreciate that the delivery of devolved social security has taken, it isn't the fact of the matter that had to move emphasis and resources because of the pandemic. Simply, I know that in a previous response and associated with would result in charge for the diff. Your intention is ability benefit. Should the DWP changing ensure that this benefits rather than punishing the Scottish Government for doing so?
Convener, I'm terribly sorry. We couldn't hear that clearly enough to be able to answer it.
Yeah, no, I completely understand that, and it's maybe something that we would need to follow up in writing with yourself, because I think us in the room got some of it, and then it really sped up at the end, and we couldn't quite catch what Emma was saying, unfortunately, there. I'm going to have to move on to the next theme, and I've got questions from Natalie Dawn, who also joins us remotely. Mm-hmm. Natalie?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. It's nice to have you here with us this morning. In relation to the Scottish Child Payment, can you advise how the DWP are progressing delivery on the agreed transfer of data from the UK Government to the Scottish Government, and can you confirm if this is on track?
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Dawn. We are indeed working closely together. I believe it is on track. This is something actually where Mr McPherson and I have had very close discussions recently, and officials are working extremely
tightly to be able to get the data that is needed in the way that is needed, and to support the transfer. I'm very happy for Andrew to take more technical questions than that, but I hope I can give you that assurance in answer to your first question.
I would only supplement that by saying that, yeah, we've had extensive discussions with the Scottish Government at a technical level, and some of it relates to what I was saying earlier about incompatible IT systems. Particularly, it is not just universal credit that gives rise to the Scottish Child Payment, it's other benefits as well, which do not have the same data structures. It's a very technical issue. It's not that the DWP doesn't want to provide this, clearly we do want to provide this information to the Scottish Government. It's a question of, if I put it crassly, I'm a policy person, not a technician, but if I might put it crassly, does DWP change its systems to fit with what the Scottish Government system has, or does the Scottish Government change its system to accept the data in the format in which DWP holds it? And that is kind of, well, that shouldn't be something that needs to go into the public domain, that should be behind the scenes. And I think it unsettles people, and I think it's unfortunate that we get into discussions about those technical issues, which unsettle people unnecessarily, because we are definitely going to be providing them with the information to the Scottish Government that the Scottish Government requires.
Thank you. That's good to know that we're on track. Now, obviously, the Scottish Child Payment is aimed at tackling poverty head-on. It's a very ambitious programme. Can I ask if the Minister recognises the hybrid nature of devolved benefits and accepts that if Scotland is to have low-income benefits that are going to help tackle poverty in this way and help people with the cost of living crisis that we're seeing just now, then the Scottish Government needs that data of eligibility, which is obviously reserved, as you've just touched upon, and that needs to be from the UK Government. And if this is genuinely a joint programme of work, again, as you've just touched on, the Scottish Government cannot be thwarted in our aims to use these powers to help people that are reliant on the data from the UK Government. So I would ask the Minister what you would suggest as the way forward to ensure that joint cooperation.
Well, I think we have the methods already in hand of joint cooperation. And what I can add to my assurances is that actually I and Ben McPherson actually are explicitly agreed that our joint efforts and our commitment to resolve this on both sides have already secured the agreed approach to the provision of data which supports the proposed delivery timeline of the Scottish Government. And indeed, Ben has thanked me for that in letters. Thank you again for DWP's contribution so far and continued commitment to delivery of the extended Scottish Child Payment. I wouldn't say that is the action of a pair of ministers who are trying to thwart each other in any way.
Thank you. I appreciate those answers. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on to Pam Duncan-Glancy for her questions on this theme.
Thank you, Convener. The rollout of the Scottish Child Payment to over sixes has taken some time. What pressure has the Scottish Government put on the Department of Work and Pensions to move faster to do this, if at all? And what assurances have the Scottish Government sought that the DWP's strategic solution will be operational by the time of the rollout?
Thank you, Ms. Duncan-Glancy. I mean, there's a number of, a number of points that we could provide in answer to that, and Andrew may want to confirm, the full kind of history and extent of discussions. But I mean, I think the key point is those discussions have been lengthy. We're all aware of the pressing timetable, and we have reached agreement on how to do it. I think the committee will be aware of the history, if you like, in the sense that there was a different type of data that related to the under sixes compared to the over sixes, and that has been the thing that we've needed to resolve. But we've done so, and I think that's really important because it allows us then to get on and do it, which for me is the absolute priority. I mean, I wouldn't describe any of those things as pressure being put by one government on another. I would just describe this as us having had to roll our sleeves up and work out how to do it. Andrew, would you like to add anything to that?
Yes, I think if we've learned one thing from the SCB and SCB2 issue, it is to make sure that the two governments are talking to each other in advance and not making assumptions. And I think we're getting better at that. So we were already providing data to the Scottish Government to administer the Best Start grant for children under the age of six. And kindly request for them as well. I think there may have been a misunderstanding that that data was available in exactly the same format for children over the age of six. And it's really simple. It matters just lifting up the phone and asking, is this data available in that format, yes or no? And if not, can it be made available in that format? And do that before making announcements.
Yes, thank you. That's really helpful. And so at what point did the Scottish Government ask that particular question?
I'm afraid I think the point is that they didn't necessarily do so. And we would very much prefer that to be a thing that happened in the future if we ever were to find ourselves in a similar position. As Andrew says, the really key point here is that we need to be able to have these discussions first, before promises are made. Around this committee table, we are all politicians. I'm sure we all love to make promises, but we have to do that in a responsible way that is backed up by a sensible knowledge of what can technically be achieved and by when.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you, Pam. We're going to actually bring Emma back in, who has questions on this theme as well. Broadcasting are quite hopeful that we've got a better connection. So Emma, let's try again. Thanks. Nope, I don't.
Hello, can you hear me?
We can hear you, yes, yep.
Okay, sorry, you kind of broke up on my end there, so I was just making sure. I noted in a previous response that Andrew advised further costs associated with changing eligibility due to more disabled people being eligible would result in the Scottish Government being charged for the difference. So I wanted to ask if your intention is, as you say, to get disability benefits to all who need it, should the DWP not be leading on changing eligibility to make sure that this happens with reserve benefits rather than punishing the Scottish Government for doing so?
Thank you very much for being able to put your question technically more clearly, because now we've got you loud and clear. I just reject this characterisation. I'm really sorry. I just don't think it's at all appropriate to be talking in terms of one government punishing another when actually we need to be able to be working together to help people. I really think we can perhaps do better than that. I'll give Andrew an opportunity if he'd like to refine his, come back to what he said earlier in order to answer your fresh question. But I think the point is we need to think sensibly and collaboratively actually about the population that we're seeking to support and the nature of what we each together understand to be disability or ill health, and be able to ensure that the support is there. The idea that people may unfortunately suffer a particular change in their health in the future, or that may have functional impairments from a disability is not something that should be taken as an excuse for a bum fight. It's something that we need to be able to support people with, and we will.
Thank
Andrew,
you.
Would you like to add anything?
I think the only thing I would add is I think there is also an issue here. Of course, we are all concerned primarily with the customer. And the customer's experience, and that's the point that is being made here. I was making a comment, which is a more technical comment, about how you account behind the scenes for who's going to make the payments.
Yes.
So the payment needs to be made, and also in the case of the Christmas bonus, many people will receive it anyway, because actually they're in receipt of multiple benefits, each of which would give them a rise to a Christmas bonus. It's if we could isolate the point where the UK government has forecast a certain amount of expenditure based on these are the criteria on which people get a Christmas bonus, and a few people in Scotland get an extra Christmas bonus, which was not budgeted for, then that's going to need to be paid for in some way.
And may I add, just finally, I understand that the committee may want to put some questions about the fiscal framework or kind of, broader budgetary points at the end of the session, but, the point, of course, is that the Scottish Government will receive the biggest funding settlement since devolution, and that's from the spending review in autumn of last year. Indeed, over the next 3 years, the devolved administrations are all receiving at least 20% more per person than the equivalent UK government spending. So those are the fundamentals of actually how budgeting works, as obviously every committee member will know, the block grant, Barnett consequentials, how we make the sums add up behind the scenes in order to get the support to where it is needed.
Thank you. Emma, did you have a question, a further question?
No, I think I'll leave it there. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. We will now move on to the last theme, which is round about the fiscal framework. And my colleague Jeremy Balfour has a question.
Yeah, just two very quick questions, Minister. I think they're more just kind of to get some kind of information of where we are. I know back in October 21, both governments asked for an independent report on the fiscal framework. I just wondered, could you update us where we are on that, and when are we likely to see any of the workings from this independent review coming into the public domain?
That would ideally be a question that you might be able to put to the Treasury. So in terms of the UK government, it's that department that would lead on that. So I'm afraid I'm not able to give you that detail that you're asking for today.
OK, thank you. We can maybe take that up in a letter. I miss you, the answer may be the same in regard to my final question, and that is, has any thought been given, or do you know, had the independent review been asked to look at if there is divergence within social security system, how that would be dealt with within any fiscal framework going forward? Again, that may be a question for the Treasury rather than for you.
Yes, it's certainly a question that I can recognise. Although, as I say, the Treasury is conducting the independent, is conducting the review, and you may want to get further information from them. I mean, at a general level, the principles around social security are, of course, already addressed in the current framework. And I would say that, despite all we've discussed this morning, Policy divergences haven't actually materialised significantly at this stage in terms of social security. So I think it would be difficult and, of course, hypothetical to argue what might need to change in the existing framework. So the really practical answer is that it's too early to tell. And I think my expectation would be, therefore, that this would not be a core part of the fiscal framework review being done at present.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer, and thank you for your time this morning. It's much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of our questions. I would just like to say my own thanks to yourself and your officials for coming by this morning. I think you've given the committee a lot to think about, and I think the key thing going forward is going to be the collegiate working between both sets of governments and the twin tracks of the independent review and obviously your own looking at the changes that maybe are going to be made to your own disability benefits. So thank you very much, and hopefully we'll have further conversations in the future.
Well, may I thank you, Ms. Whitton, for having us, and on behalf of my officials and I, it was good to hear your questions, and we look forward to working closely with you in the future.
Thank you very much. I am now going to suspend briefly and give members a moment for a comfort break. We'll bring ourselves back in about 10 minutes at the most, and we are a wee bit ahead of schedule, so okay. Thank you very much, everybody. Welcome back to this morning's meeting. We're now at agenda item number 3, which is subordinate legislation. We're going to consider 4 negative SSIs. As outlined on the agenda, the negative instruments under consideration are disability assistance for working age people, consequential and miscellaneous amendment and transitional provision, Scotland Regulations 2022, and carers allowance uprating, miscellaneous amendment, Scotland Regulations 2022, social security, industrial injuries, prescribed diseases, amendment, Scotland Regulations 2022, and council tax reduction, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. Members are invited to consider all 4 of these instruments together. Background information is outlined in papers 3 to 6. Do members have any comments they would like to raise in relation to these instruments? And if you do have comments, it would be helpful if you could highlight which instrument they relate to. Pam Duncan-Clancy, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. First, on SSI, on council tax reduction, it would be helpful, I think, to know whether the government has any plans to gather data on the numbers of people who access council tax reduction and who they are. And also, do we know how many people, if any, have missed out as a result of the error that is noted in the papers, and will their payment be given back? Like, will that be backdated? So I don't know if that's something that the committee may wish to write to the government about, or I still intend to vote for the SSI, but I just thought it would be worth asking those questions.
Yep. Did any members have any comments on that? I'm content for us to write to seek clarity on those points raised. Yep. Are we agreed? Online, are we agreed with that as well? Yep. That's great. Pam, did you have a further comment?
Unsurprisingly, the other one is on the SSI, on the uprating to carers allowance, and it's just to say that whilst any increase is welcome, I'm still disappointed that it is, of course, only £4, and that we're not able to look, or that the government haven't looked at the adequacy of carers allowance any sooner than they have. So I just wanted to put that on record that £4 is welcome because it's an increase, but it is absolutely nowhere near enough, and I hope that the Scottish Government move as quickly as possible to addressing the rate of carers allowance and eligibility for it. But I will, of course, vote for the SSI.
Thank you very much. Your comments are now on record and will be noted within the minute of the meeting. Therefore, I ask all members, are we content to note the SSIs? Yep. That's brilliant. Thank you very much. That does conclude the public part of this morning's meeting. At next week's meeting, we'll be considering the medium-term financial strategy and framework for resource spending review, as well as considering affirmative subordinate legislation. We're now going to move into private session to consider our remaining agenda items. Members who are joining us online should leave this meeting now and join us via the Teams link in your calendar. Thank you very much, everybody.